10 minutes later, she comes out and tells her secretary, Mr. Grant has just promised $25,000. But she got the money from him.
I always felt she was like a queen, very regal, very sure of herself, but like every monarch, there was kind of a soft side, and there was occasionally even a dark side.
I was ahead of my time. I did what I did on my own. No help from anybody.
I mean, in her time, she was a powerhouse. But everybody starts to kind of aggrandize one's own position when you start remembering the past.
Emboldened by her successful campaign to save the Hollywood Bowl, Dorothy Chandler had a dream to create a downtown entertainment complex that would rival the world's greatest performing arts centers. Three venues in which to showcase theater, music, and dance, or to host special events like the Academy Awards. The city would give her the downtown property, but Dorothy Chandler had to raise the $19 million required for initial construction. She began by building a coalition of two powerful communities, but barely spoke to one another.
And her particular mission or crusade, undertaken against many of the members of her husband's family, was to try and begin to bridge some of the social political difference between the two urban elites, the old downtown elite, white, Anglo-Saxon, and Protestant, and the largely Jewish West Side elite.
When I started the Music Center Building Fund, I decided I would never have meetings in the California Club because they had a very firm policy about no Jewish people. And I'm not like that. Some of my very best friends are Jewish. I felt the Music Center was going to be something to serve the entire community and not the downtown establishment.
What she did, I still think, is just tremendous. She just didn't take no for an answer easily, ever. And she got so that she kind of enjoyed fundraising.
I read the financial pages more than I do the social pages. For corporations and for successful men, I never miss the financial section. That's where you get your leads.
Every store in Beverly Hills and downtown Los Angeles had these brown paper bags where people would put in $1. And she collected her last million from the people of Los Angeles giving $1 each in those buck bags.
Just think, all the money for this beautiful center was raised by voluntary contributions. Voluntary. That's when Buff stopped twisting your arm so you could sign the check.
In a 1964 cover story, Time magazine hailed Dorothy Chandler's effort as perhaps the most impressive display of virtuoso money raising in the history of U.S. womanhood. She may have brought the city together, but on opening night at the Dorothy Chandler Pavilion, the same could not be said of her Chandler in-laws, who never accepted the strong-willed Buff as one of their own.
At the opening of the Music Center, you know, I don't think there was other branches of the family that were there. I was not aware. We were seated in the front few rows. There weren't other family members there that weren't from Norman and Buff's branch.
Certainly, all I heard, even here, was that we were in a cultural desert. You don't hear that anymore. And it is Mrs. Chandler who we should thank for that. There is no question about it. Without that music center, the culture would not have rocketed as it has.
I'm not a person that loves every little baby. I'm not that kind of a mother.
Well, Mia always felt that Buff's favorite was Otis, which is true. Buff just got along better with men than she did women. Same was true with their children.
Remember who you are and what you represent, was a phrase Dorothy drilled into her son Otis. She would say that Harry Chandler counted on him, his grandson, to carry on the Chandler legacy, an ambition Buff shared.
I was going to make something of myself as an individual, apart from make something of me as a Chandler, where it's expected, where you live on your family and your father's reputation. They never force me to be the best at whatever I do. That somehow came from within me. And I never remember a period when I would settle for mediocrity. Never.
I would describe him as a C or C plus student who became an A student through sheer focus and assiduous attention to what it was he was trying to focus on. He was amazing that way. He was pretty secure in his own self.
As a Stanford senior, Otis Chandler heaved a shot put 8 inches shy of a world record. But he missed the 1952 Helsinki Olympics due to a wrist injury. He considered it one of the biggest disappointments of his life.
The Chandlers wanted him to marry me. In fact, they gave him the engagement ring in February. And we planned this big wedding in June of 1951, and I was 19 years old when I married Otis. And the Chandlers were thrilled because he was going out with a nice girl instead of some of the other ones that they had met.
It came as no surprise to Otis Chandler when his father presented him with a 7-year executive training program at the Times. He started in the press room on the night shift, then did a stint in each department. His favorite, the year he spent as a reporter. Unlike his father and grandfather, he grasped what his great-grandfather General Otis understood, that the newsroom was the heartbeat of the business. Though the Times had always made money, journalistically, it was considered by the industry among the worst big city papers in the country.
We were excluded, and that really upset me. It was a real wake-up call. You may be a Chandler and you may be working on the LA Times, but there's no credit in terms of your peer group. So I tucked that away and I must have said to myself, well, if I ever get the chance, I'm gonna make them eat their bloody words.
Otis wanted to show something, wanted to prove something, wanted to demonstrate that, first of all, that he was good, and also that California and Los Angeles in particular could do just as good a job journalistically, be just as important, win just as many awards, have just as much prestige as these, you know, patronizing no-good bastards over in the East.
There was no push by my father. I understood later that my mother tried to push him, but he didn't respond. He just said, it's doing fine and we're making some money, and didn't have a burning ambition to really make the Times a good paper or a great paper.
The only way, in my opinion, the Times could become a better newspaper, frankly, was to have a publisher that was young, that in general had the thoughts that I did about the Times.
I thought my father would make Philip Chandler, who was his younger brother, the next publisher.
Philip really should have been sort of next in line behind Norm in terms of moving up the ladder at the Times. And Buff simply wouldn't stand for it. A lot of people felt that it was almost unnatural, that she had some psychological problems that were forcing her to do all of these things that were offensive.
In April 1960, Norman Chandler became CEO of Times Mirror Company and named his 32-year-old son the fourth publisher of the Los Angeles Times. The appointment alienated most of Norman's family, who found Otis too young, too liberal, and too much his mother's son.
You know, the problem with the Chandlers from the start was that they were politically not on the same side. They were pulling in different directions. That is a recipe for disaster.
things were not the same ever after that. That stuck in so many people's craw that a lot of people just wrote it off.
We didn't know that there was a bunch of other cousins that, for one reason or another, didn't want to associate with us, but it didn't affect my life.
Otis Chandler and his family personified the California dream. In the beginning, many underestimated Otis Chandler because he just didn't look like the publisher of a major metropolitan newspaper.
In the case of Otis, he picked it up so fast that he didn't need my advice. Just a few months, and he picked up the ball and ran with it all by himself.
I was running too fast for him. He would have liked to, I think, kept paper and paper. Conservative paper, and he didn't like me putting black faces in the paper, or Latino faces, and running both sides of a labor management dispute.
The idea today that you would hear from on high saying, you've got to watch all those black faces on page one, too many black faces on page one, is today almost unthinkable, but it was totally expectable in those days.
Otis had a very clear vision of what he wanted the Times and Times Mirror to be. He wanted editorial quality of the highest standards, but he also wanted financial success and operational success.
More individual retail advertisers use this paper than any other daily Los Angeles metropolitan newspaper. People make markets, and markets buy products. Los Angeles is definitely a blue chip market.
In 1 year, Otis Chandler had replaced 18 of 21 department heads. After three, he had tripled the news budget, hired a national editor, and opened bureaus around the world. The new Los Angeles Times would report the news and investigate it.
What Otis Chandler did changed a lot about Los Angeles because of making a first-rate paper here with a very good investigative reporters locally and nationally. It made a major difference in Los Angeles to have a paper of that caliber.
While we played happily at our little games, the communists were taking the world. The John Birch Society was born. Merely being patriotic or anti-communist is not sufficient qualification for membership.
In 1961, the Times ran a five-part series exposing the reactionary bigotry of the John Birch Society, a fear-mongering group that labeled President Eisenhower a Soviet dupe and the United Nations a communist front.
A woman doesn't have to be a genius to see that their little protected world of lace, luncheons, and frying pans has suddenly collapsed into a nightmare of raw violence and brutality.
John Birch Society members included Norman Chandler's brother Philip and wife Alberta. The family divide widened.
And I guess some of the other families went along and believed those kind of crazy John Birch ideas. And, you know, the Philip Chandlers were not our bosom buddies.
Now, Phil never got over that. He was very disappointed, and I think Alberta, his wife, was even more disappointed because they were very right-wing and the cause of a lot of family dissension. I wouldn't say Phil was the dissenter so much as Alberta. She had a sharp tongue.
The John Birch series outraged enough longtime customers